I don't have a time problem. I have a continuity problem. The time problem has no value for me whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Welcome. No body, no world, no problem. Welcome to the video. Keep in mind the times that we live in. Very important. Today is the 100th anniversary of the beginning of World War I, which happened very, very fast, right? Because of all the mutual treaties that were involved, that it was just a matter of days, boom, 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 full-fledged insanity taking place. I've said that World War III has already started in this world. Understand this, World War III is essentially a battle for your attention. Our attention is always invested somehow. Somehow. Notice I didn't say somewhere, I said somehow. Because where it should be invested is on everywhere. The everywhereness, the oneness. That's where our attention naturally is, rests on the oneness, which is reality. We have it now resting on bodies and worlds and things. This is a dream, actually. Severe dream. Now, the war is over our attention. There is that dynamic that wants to keep our attention on bodies and things, on form, which means location, which means time, which means space. And there are those who want to liberate our attention so that it is free and it rests upon the allness, the oneness. Jesus said to us that don't fear those who can destroy the body. Fear those who can destroy the soul. Now the soul, this is a metaphor speaking for our attention, basically. And our attention can't be destroyed. But it can rest upon that which can disintegrate form. It can rest upon the belief in time and space. And as such, it feels as though we're dying. When we value form, when we value definition, we're valuing our own death. Not literally, because we're spirit and attention and that cannot die. But we believe as though we can die, and we fear that we can die, and this is a terrible thing. So this war is for your attention, all right? And this is way more serious than World War I, the bodies being, you know, blown up here and there and all that. Yeah, okay, it's way more serious, because where your attention is, that's your world, that's your reality for you. And if you believe that your attention is naturally supposed to rest upon form and definition, naturally, if you believe that big lie, then you are going to doom yourself to a long, long sojourn fearing death in the realm of what's called hell. Hell. Now, hell's a dream, it's a hallucination, but hallucinations seem very real to those who are hallucinating. So, truly, it is repent or go to hell. Meaning, repent means shift your attention off of definition onto the allness, to the oneness, or else you are going to dwell in the land of death. Death. All definitions are subject to redefinition, right? All forms are subject to collapse, decay, and collapse. We have this tremendous war raging right now. Now, 28th is a very important day. I had a tremendous breakthrough yesterday. That understanding that our problem is that we have a superiority complex. And we scoff and mock at those who don't share our superiority complex, afraid that our house of cards will come tumbling down. That is the problem. It's difficult to get any information here into the world to help out, because people tend to easily caught up in this superiority complex to say, well, I got a body, you know, I'm in a world, I've got definition, I'm superior to that which doesn't have definition. I'm in prison, I'm superior to that which is free. You know, hey, look at this great prison I'm in. It's upside down and backwards here. But what to do about this insane conflict that's raging now in the world, fueled by Hollywood, entertainment industry, the news industry, all right? Activists of all types. There's a tremendous institutional push to get our attention onto bodies, okay? Instead of the mind, instead of our attention, instead of content, our attention should be on attention. Okay, let's put it that way. We should be focusing on where is our attention going? Where is our attention going? That is why meditation, silent sitting is so important, is give you a chance to look and see where is my attention? Where is my attention? And then watch the play of attention in your own sphere. Watch the play of attention and see what pulls it here, pulls it there, pushes there. Look and see of all the tricks that are used to push your attention certain places, to pull it certain places. And you become more and more aware of how there's this massive effort to keep tricking our attention, to keep bullying our attention, to keep demanding, pressuring our attention, to keep our attention on bodies and form. And when our attention is there, it's very easy to control us. We're very easily controlled, easily enslaved, easily brainwashed by those who are very experienced and very cynical, the hardliners of the Luciferian hellish realms who want to set up a kingdom here, a kingdom with them at the top, and everybody else, they're slaves, actually. That's the goal. That's the goal of all this. Whereas in reality, when you're not in this hallucination, not dreaming that you're in this hallucination, it's all freedom for all. All are equal. All are equally free. All are have equal standing in the one eternal family, the one family of eternal life. So where we are placing our attention is absolutely critical right now. And it's kind of a very tough day because not only is it the anniversary of this, you know, incredible debacle of World War I, but it's also a day where World War III is extremely, felt so extremely strong, and the dominoes may be falling even as we speak. And what does that mean? Does it mean armed conflict? Not necessarily, not necessarily. It could be part of it for sure, getting your attention on the television, looking at bodies, all right? You don't want to look at bodies. Now, obviously, you're in a world you're gonna see bodies, at least most of us, not everyone. Some see just golden light instead of bodies. If you're going to have your attention on bodies at all, don't let it be directly on the body. Let it just be on what the body is saying, what a body is saying, what is being communicated, what is being communicated. All right? So guard your attention, guard your attention. We can all do a better job. I can do a better job. I know that too. Guard your attention. Do not put your attention on bodies. Okay, that's very important. Even a great guru's body, do not put your attention there. Put your attention on what the message is. Put your attention on what the message is, not the messenger. We are not bodies, we are free. We are as God created us to be. No body, no world, no problem. No body, no world, no problem. We think like, oh, if we stop hallucinating, there won't be anything. No, there'll be everything. There'll be everywhere. But we don't realize that. So we have to be careful in stopping our hallucinating. We have a continuity problem. We have a continuity problem. So I don't have a time problem. I have a continuity problem. The time problem has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Now, reality doesn't have any needs, but from a practical standpoint, we need to evaporate our continuity problem. We can't just stop hallucinating instantly right now, because the continuity fear, like, oh my gosh, there's an abyss or what? Well, I don't know what's there, maybe an abyss. So we do practically have the need of evaporating our continuity problem. Therefore, in that context, we have a need. And this need needs to be met. You know, we don't want to keep delaying unnecessarily, keep delaying more and more and more. So I'd say this time has a need. It's very, very needy time in terms of doing something that helps out. Something dramatic, something drastic, some big move, big shift here. As far as our attention goes, we're losing the battle of our attention here. Most are losing the battle. It's not about which bodies win and which bodies lose. It's about freeing your attention from bodies. It's about freeing your attention from any storyline at all. Now, let's get to the nitty-gritty here. When we choose duality, when we choose to be greater than God, we're choosing duality, which means we believe there's something greater, which means also something lesser. The lesser is not as great as the greater. The greater is greater than the lesser. That's duality. Reality doesn't have any such duality. There is nothing greater than God, but we chose to believe there is. On a whim, no proof whatsoever. We just thought that if we search for it, we can find it. It's just an adventure. Let's go search for something greater than God. It was an adventure on our part. But it's got us into a lot of fear and confusion. Greater and lesser duality. When you are in a dualistic hallucination, which we are right now, hallucinating depth, which there isn't any depth, there's no greater or lesser in reality. There's no distance, so to speak, is nearer and farther from the ground of being. Reality is zero dimensional, meaning that there is no way to distance yourself from it. Okay, so there's no depth in that regard. When we choose that this dualistic hallucination and to put our attention on it, primarily put our attention on it, it's impossible to not see something that is appealing within it. We're going to have some craving, we're going to have something that we feel is appealing to us, for sure. Some storyline is going to appeal to us for sure, and will then suck us into craving for it, and we'll follow our desire for it, and we'll be just totally entangled and enmeshed in this. So it's impossible to have your attention on this dualism and at the same time get rid of all desire, all craving, all intrigue. Can't do it that way. That's not the way. And this is very, very important. So, when you want to turn your attention away from this story, all the storylines we call the people in the world, and get it on the absolute, non-dual absolute, what you see as you're turning your attention away is there's going to be some glittery aspect of this dream, hallucination, that will seem intriguing, and you won't be able to purify it, all of it. You will not be able to purify all of it, okay? Not from that standpoint, not from the standpoint of the dream. You cannot purify all of it. It's only when you accept this fact that you cannot, quote unquote, purify time. You cannot purify time. It's impossible. Time itself is the corrupter. You cannot purify time. If you believe in time at all, some aspect is going to seem very appealing to you. So you have to get your attention off of time altogether in order to succeed. Do not try to succeed by trying to purify the content of time and space. That's not possible. But we're very, very clearly, we define that as enlightenment, as liberation, is that the final purification. And no, it's a trick. It's a trap. It's a trap. There is no enlightenment in time. There is no purification in time. And this is the final trap, the final trick, and it trips us all up for sure. Very difficult to get our attention off of, time altogether. Just time is one condition, just one condition. But that's what has to happen. In other words, there isn't any sub-enlightenment. There isn't any time-based enlightenment at all. At all. There is not. None. 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 This is what we have to realize. This is the burn that I talk about. This is the realization. When you're realizing this, that does produce this burn in us, so to speak. It's not that painful. It's just a feeling of, like, discomfort. Being in a sauna kind of thing, right? A little discomforting, but you know it's good for you. So you say, oh, this is great. I enjoy this. Now, of course, our continuity fear wants us to find some time-based enlightenment, right? So it'll want us to push in that direction, and we just have to say no. No, I'm not pushing in that any direction. So the purpose of sitting quietly is to not push in any direction. You may think we're pushing for enlightenment. No, we're not pushing in any direction. And that itself frees us up. Time is always directional, is it not? It has to do with process. Process is always has some sense of depth, right? Something is... That depth is this and this are linked. There's some depth there, right? Reality is not that way. It's not linked. Moments are not linked. There is no process. Everything is spontaneous. Everything is instantaneous. So by sitting and doing nothing, this is liberating us from time, from time. So you're not going to think and you're not going to not think. You're just sort of holding this sort of neutrality, this position of neutrality. And that's enough to evaporate the continuity fear. You hold this position of neutrality. As I have said, if Jesus walks by right now, and he may very well do that, it's entirely possible. But just keep the position of neutrality. Keep the position of neutrality. You're not grabbing anything. You're not letting anything go. You're not pushing away anything. You're not doing anything. And I'm not doing anything. You can just deepen this neutrality, deepen this neutrality. And gently let go of time, the belief in time. So no body, no world, no problem. No body, no world, no problem. No layers, no levels, only oneness. No layers, no levels, only zeroness. No layers, no levels, only zeroness. No layers, no levels, only zeroness. No, no body, no world, no problem. I don't have a time problem, I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The time problem has no value for me whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This helps neutrality. I do not have a time problem. I do not have a time problem. I have a continuity problem. You step out of time, say, I'm willing to step out of time because I know that there's still going to be a process of honoring time. There's still going to seem like this honoring time is still going to take place, but you're conscious of what's going on, why you're doing this, you see. You're conscious. It's not a problem anymore. It's not a time problem. It's a continuity problem. I do not have a time problem, I have a continuity problem. A continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I don't have any other problem whatsoever. The time problem has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me because it solves the continuity problem. Just keep on with these types of affirmations and remain doing nothing, not doing anything. No body, no world, no problem. So what we're doing is we're getting our attention off of duality altogether instead of trying to purify it, okay? Don't try to purify time. Don't try to purify time. This is the great mistake. Don't try to bring yourself to purity. You are purity. You are purity. Reality is completely pure already. Always has been. Never been contaminated. Don't try to make yourself pure. Try to get your attention off of time is what is important. Because the world is trying to get your attention onto time so severely now, the war is so severe, drastic non-action needs to be taken. Drastic non-action needs to be taken. And will be taken. Most don't know. They think that having their attention on bodies and the world and things, and time and space, is some kind of superiority. See, they think, well, no, nothing's wrong. I feel very superior to some other condition. This is great. Superiority complex is what rules the world. But the price of the superiority complex is death. The price is insecurity. The price is confusion. The price is fear. So many, many don't want this superiority complex anymore. They say, I'll be fine just without time. So we need to prove to ourselves we can get our attention off the off bodies and off the world. And so for many, sitting silently doing nothing with the eyes closed for a prolonged period of time, not dreaming of bodies, not imagining bodies, just say, no body, no world, no problem. I am not a body, I am free, I am as God created me. Helps prove to themselves that, hey, there's no abyss, I can do this, it's not a problem. But certainly at this time in the world, it will seem like a very scary thing to do, like a very bold step to take. Because never in the world have we been able to showcase so many bodies, right? With all these television channels, internet channels, movies, news, everything. We can highlight any of 7 billion bodies on this planet now to us. And say, so we can put, you know, our attention cameras, our attention, anywhere on this planet and bring live to you bodies you haven't seen before. Look at those interesting bodies. And because of the customs of the modern world, we can bring bodies to you in all different states of dress and undress, you see. And so 7 billion people, cameras everywhere. We think, wow, this is amazing, you know. I can just look at those bodies. Wow, look at those bodies. Those are interesting bodies, and like that. And we can also look at dead bodies, at constant wars going on and gruesome stuff. The news is constantly promoting the most gruesome sort of stuff with pictures, etc. And we can look at those bodies and say, wow, look at that body. So it's more difficult now than in the past. Bodies are super intrusive right now into our attention. This is what the intrusion is. This is the war. It's trying to intrude upon your attention as much as possible with music. You go in almost any store, they've got some music, which what is this doing? Singing about the body, focusing on the body, and how incredibly wonderful it is, and how they've never felt so great, and it's just like unbelievable. I like classic country music in terms of how they treat the body. It's like, wow, this is terrible. Yeah, how will I never see you again? Like that. I say, that's refreshing. That's very refreshing. You know, say, she's come back, but I know what she's after. She don't love me. She's just lonesome again. I know it's going to turn out bad. You know, I know it's going to turn out bad. Yeah, that's classic country. Hey, I know this body thing is going to turn out bad, for sure. It's like that helps us out, actually. It's like, wow, yeah, that's true. She's come back. But I know what she's after. She ain't lonesome. I mean, she don't love me. She's just lonesome again. Look out, heart. Look out, heart. I can tell you are leaning. I can feel that old heartache begin. She's come back. I know what she's after. She don't love me. She's just lonesome again. That is exactly right. So the songs, the advertisement, the way people dress, look at me, look at the body, this, you know, look, the attitude, you know, it's not like, hey, I've got something tremendous to share with you about freedom and liberation, liberating our attention from hallucinating form. It's not like people walk around with that. They'll walk around and say, hey, don't I look like I just stepped off the pages of a magazine? Right? Isn't this great? I mean, this body, isn't this great? Nobody is saying, hey, isn't my mind great anymore? Isn't my mind great? I mean, the ideas, the thoughts, the considerations, the attention, isn't this fantastic? We need to get our attention on those, that which is saying, hey, my mind is fantastic. My mind is tremendous. The clarity is tremendous. Get our attention on the content, okay, of our awareness. Get our attention there. I can say for sure, as going about my life here in this world, nobody's ever stopped me and says, hey, you look like you might have something to share that's important. Not even one time out in the world, for instance. Out in the world? No, never. Everybody is too busy being superficial, judging one another superficially. Oh, look at that body. That's an interesting body. Look at that body. How's that body looking? I said, hey, forget about bodies. Does anyone have some help for me to get free of this, of death? You know? I guess people don't even imagine it's even possible. But for those who do imagine it's possible, who realize it's possible, we certainly need that which has great content, and we're in desperate need of it. So I'll try my best to supply that for the world. That's my aim. I said, yes, I'll do that. That's not a problem. My mind is flexible enough, you know, my attention, I understand it's flexible enough to provide great content that people can say, hey, I love that content. I love the content here. Now, the continuity problem is a huge problem. This is what I've been struggling with the whole life here. I said, people, folks in the world, can we not all agree that we need some great teachers here who have, you know, off-the-charts content? Can we not all get together on this and say that we've got to have this or else we're going to sink? And could not do it. And during these times, too tough. And unfortunately, it's tragedy, absolute tragedy. Is the multimedia, the whole entertainment news, gadget, high-tech industry all together. Cause people to lose their focus and they said, hey, this is really interesting, all these bodies, you know, it's very interesting. I'm not really interested in content of mind. I'm kind of interested in all these bodies. And that's the great failing of the times, of these end times, which we're warned about by Jesus, absolutely warned about. As people's attention will be so much off of spirit, off of truth, off of the formless, onto form, definition, bodies, and all that, that it will never even occur to them that there could be something better. It won't even occur to them to even ask. It's like, hey, why don't we ask? What if Jesus were right here, right now, in person, live and in person, for instance? How would that work out? You know, probably not so great right now. People wouldn't necessarily know how to benefit from it, actually. You know, they'd be too emotionalized, too triggered. They really would. That's my perspective on it. Is it, you know, just what we should do is just sit quietly, take advantage of the situation and reassurance, like, hey, get our attention off of bodies, off the world, off of form. Get our attention into the non-dual absolute, understanding there is no depth at all. All storylines are equally flat. We're all flatliners. It's all a flatlining here. It's all flatlining here. That's all it is. Get our attention off of time. Realize time is it doesn't exist. And get the reassurance, and then listen to the content that Jesus provides, what he says to us. And just let it sink in. Just let it sink in. And that's it. That's it. But is that what would happen? Is that what would happen actually? I wouldn't say so. So we really put ourselves in a bind. Intentionally, our spiritual pride has done it to us. Our superiority complex has done it to us. We saw an opportunity to what we thought would become even more superior, get more used to bodies, all sorts of bodies, this whole let's be tolerant and all-inclusive means let's get our attention on all bodies. Hey, these bodies are great too. These bodies are great too. The more bodies, the merrier. And let's celebrate the body. Let's put it on a pedestal. The whole world's about celebrating the body. Beautiful now, that's it. This is the Antichrist religion, actually. This is the Luciferian agenda. Keep your attention on form, which is death, which is... But ultimately, it's our desire, it's our belief there's something greater than God, and we're going to find it. And when we find that realm, so to speak, like there's a realm beyond God, if we get into that realm, we're going to be greater than God. So what we're doing is we're rehearsing to get into that realm. We're imagining, what would that realm be like? And so we've made this scenario of worlds and bodies because that's our best guesstimate of what this realm would be like, okay? And so we're simply trying to get used to it, trying to get familiar so that when we shift into this realm, we'll feel like, ah, this feels like home. This feels like home. This is great. So we're just rehearsing. This whole body world thing is just a rehearsal. It is nothing but a dress rehearsal. Because there's a fact. Nothing but a dress rehearsal. We haven't shifted into any realm, actually, other realm at all. We never will. We never will. So all this dress rehearsal is much ado about absolutely nothing. And we don't have to put our attention on it. We're not doing anyone any favors by putting our attention on it and saying, wow, you're rehearsing really great. Look at you. Look at you. Look how nice you look. You're rehearsing great. That's good. We don't need to do that. We can just be quiet. We can just be silent. We can just greet one another and keep our focus on shifting our attention off of time, off of rehearsal. The whole Luciferian agenda is just a rehearsal agenda in the belief that it will then enable us to shift into this quote-unquote higher realm. There is no higher realm. There are no realms. There's only one reality. It's all one. Now, understandably, this is difficult. It's difficult to get your attention off the rehearsal because if you do, you feel like you're missing the rehearsal. It's like, let's say there was a play being put on, you're rehearsing for the play, and it's very intense, and you have to learn your lines, and the play's coming up soon, and you start missing rehearsals 2 days, 3 days. You know your lines. You're not going to know your lines. You're not going to be able to be in the play. And you get all nervous and all worried. Oh my gosh, this is terrible. I'm a loser. So we're scared to get our attention off of this rehearsal. Keep in mind, this play will never go on stage. Keep in mind, this play will never, ever go on stage. It's very important to realize that. What we're doing, what the world is doing in the next 2 years, is a mock staging. Okay, a mock staging. Don't think it's the real thing. There is no real thing. But it will intrigue people enough, they'll think, wow, I need to go along with this mock staging, staging the mock play, because that'll really get me ready for the real thing. The real thing never arrives. There is no shift into any other realm. This is all hallucination. It's not a realm. Reality is not a realm either. It's all one. There's only just one realm. Just oneness. So it's okay to miss rehearsals because there's no play. In fact, it's those that are rehearsing to go on stage, do the play. Those are the ones that are falling behind. Because the real play here is to forget your lines. Forget your acting. Let go of all that training, the rehearsal training. Not to purify it, but be willing to let go in the terms of shifting your attention off of time itself, off of this, the illusion of depth, of greater and lesser, of duality. To see the non-necessity of the lines is another way to put it. The non-necessity of the rehearsal is to accept the total non-necessity of it. Not to purify it, accept the total non-necessity of it. Okay, not to purify it, but to accept the total non-necessity of it. This is what produces the burn. To practice at the with the non-necessity aspect of it. Non-necessity. No necessity whatsoever. Absolutely no necessity to any of us. None. Zero. And let that seep into your system, as it were. And you can feel that really hits hard. Wow. These are the terms that you can feel it. If you're talking about purity, oh, there's lots of action, lots of doing. Oh, I can purify this, I can purify that. But to say there's absolutely no necessity to any of it. No necessity to any of it. To all this rehearsal. No necessity whatsoever. Just zero. And just leave it at that. Zero. Zero times zero. No necessity. Necessity is zero, and we're accepting that there isn't any necessity. There isn't any. Zero times zero, no necessity. We have zero amount of zero necessity. Hey, I have zero amount of zero necessity. Okay, this is the way that eases us out of the situation, okay? I have zero amount of zero necessity. See, at least we still think we have something, right? Yeah. That's great. I got zero amount of zero necessity. Looking at it this way, it calms us down. It calms the burn down, actually. It's like a miracle. I have zero amount of zero necessity. Okay, good. At least I got something. Yeah. Zero amount of zero necessity. Enjoying my necessity-free life that is free of necessity. I'm enjoying my necessity-free life that is free of necessity. Yeah. See, the mind, our thoughts are totally used to duality. That's all that they're about. So, our mind, our thinking needs two-ness to even think of it that there's anything there at all. So we can give it two-ness. I'm living the life-free life, or the necessity-free of necessity-freeness. I have zero amount of zero. I have zero, yeah, I've got zero amount of zero. And then the mind feels stable and says, oh yeah, okay, I'm stable, I'm good, I'm cool, everything's good, everything's good. We don't want to destroy the mind, destroy thinking, all that kind of stuff. Just give it this, you know, this Zen koan almost, as a Zen koan, this, you know, this one hand clapping. Okay, there's a hand clap, there's one hand, and there's a clapping, okay. The mind says, okay. But it doesn't go anywhere, does it? It doesn't go anywhere. It doesn't generate any attachment to time. So right now I've got zero. Of zero. I've got zero of zero. Zero necessity of zero necessity. That's what I'm holding right now. Zero necessity of zero necessity. Now, what are my assets? Well, I've got zero amount of zero. I've got the zero amount of zero. That's my asset. At least I got that asset. What's your location? My location here is I'm in the location-free location freeness. My location is location freeness. So yeah, that's my location. Tell you when you try this, it's going to have an effect. You're going to feel it. It's like, wow. My location is location freeness. That's where I'm located. My assets are zero times zero, or zero amount of zero. I have zero of zero. My needs, sure. Then I have zero. I have zero needs of zero needs. Those are my needs. When you're thinking about results, this brings results. You can feel it. If you actually do it and actually accept it, you're serious about it. Somehow, this relaxes our attention enough so there's something is able to get into us, you know, the reverberations get into us. Where am I? I'm in the location-free location-freeness. I'm hanging out in location-free location-freeness. That's where I'm hanging out. Yeah. That's my 10-20, location-free location-freeness. How do I feel? How do I feel? I feel the allness of allness. I'm feeling the allness of allness. now, this feels like an extremely audacious thing, very audacious to do this, but you can certainly do it if you're committed to just sitting quietly like this, and don't try to consolidate anything, don't try to grab anything. Just let it, whatever comes, let it come. If it wants to go, let it go. What am I? I'm the body free, body freeness. I'm the body free, body freeness. Asked Longchenpa, when I saw him in the dream, he had come across this vast ocean to where I was. And I said, "Wow, you know, how was the ocean? Was it cold? Was it cold? Was the ocean cold?" And he said, "The ocean was both warm and cold. The ocean was both warm and cold." That was his response to me. And I was like, wow. Full stop right there, right? Now, most people don't do any of this because they know it's going to be impactful, and they say, "I don't have time for it. I got to go somewhere in 5 minutes." This whole scheduling thing about the world is a drastic Stone Age tactic. Actually, we're really going back to the Stone Age. The spiritual Stone Age. We are literally the spiritual Stone Age is going to collapse upon us very soon. Because nobody will, they'll say, "Hey, I got no time. They're so involved with time, they don't have time to get disinvolved with time, uninvolved with time." We have to take the time to get uninvolved with time. Take the time to get uninvolved with time. So, a success is so impactful that you won't really feel like doing much. You're just like, "Well, I just need to kind of sit here. This is just very impactful. I really don't have any notion of action right now, doing anything. So it's better I just sit here." Okay. Take the time to get your attention off of time. So all this scheduling that everyone's doing, with the smartphones, constant tweeting, constant texting, constant emailing, constant Facebooking, constant, you know, sending pictures, and scheduling. I gotta go here. I gotta go here. I gotta go here. I gotta meet so and so and so and so, and they're meeting me here, and I'm going over there, and just like that. This is what the problem is, because nowhere in anyone's day is there an opportunity to actually experience the effectiveness of getting your attention off of time, to even believe it's possible. So of course they're going to say it's impossible, because they never ever experience the effectiveness. They don't give themselves time to get free of time, get the attention off of time. You see, it's a vicious circle. That's why I say we're going to a spiritual stone age. Now, wars certainly do that, get everybody's attention, you know, schedules and everything like that. So World War I was very bad, World War II was really terrible. This war may not have so much, again, military action. Maybe some, maybe a lot, I don't know. But the war, again, is for our attention. And the war has to do with not giving ourselves any time to realize that we can get free of time. That is the war. That's how we lose the war. Now, I was very fortunate. Well, I'm sure I asked for the good fortune. In that, I was just off the beaten track, on the outskirts of town, nothing happening anywhere, just out in the suburbs, distant suburbs. Nowhere to go, nothing to do, no scheduling at all. I had no activities after school, before school, after school. I never did anything. I'd go to school, come home, that's it. So I had all the free time in the world. Just so, nothing was scheduled. So a lot of time I'd just be sitting, I'd be thinking, reading something profound and then thinking about it. That's what I do. I'd read something profound and then I just think about it. I'd spend, you know, half an hour or whatever, just I say, I wonder what they meant by that. I'm trying to see what is it, what's being said here. There are no people to go meet. I never attended any social functions, never had anybody to meet, never had to feel like I needed to, you know, get my persona all ready to meet somebody or something. No, nothing like that. Just sit. I'm still just sitting. So that's giving yourself time to get your attention off of time. That's called winning the war, winning the battle. People here say, well, you gotta do stuff. How's it gonna keep your sense of superiority? Well, it's the sense of superiority that gives rise to the fear of the abyss, which is this fear of falling into inferiority. Like just this total inferiority. Remember, as duality gives rise to the idea of the abyss, not reality. Reality is not an abyss. Reality is the impossibility of an abyss. Everything is eternally present, always. Everything shares the same eternal presence, always. No possibility of it being otherwise. And this is a fact right now. I hate scheduling. I don't schedule anything. Again, if you look at my calendar, yearly calendar, you go through the whole year, nothing on it. There's nothing on it. Every year has been that way. There's nothing on it. So we use these techniques to have a major impact on our field of expectations, so that we expect to get our attention off of time. We expect it. And we expect the mind thinking to be just fine. Because we'll say, I'm in the location, free location, freeness. That's where I am. Okay, where are you? I'm right here in the location, free location, freeness. Like that. And so it's very important for these videos to go on and on and on. Just so you get used to giving yourself time. Give yourself time to detach from time. You know, these quick little videos, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, boom, okay, I got it. That's not getting it. How can you really have a profound result if you're merely zipping onto your super hyper scheduled life, right? Valuing time, valuing storylines. So the first thing, what's the most valuable asset you have, is how you spend your time, where you put your attention, the days of your lives, where are you putting your attention? That's the most valuable asset you have. Now, Jesus says, don't put your attention on making a lot of money. Okay? Don't lay up your treasures here in this world. Very important. So, when you take your attention off of trying to make as much money as possible, then it's easier to give yourself time, more time. Now, I've given my attention so much to getting my attention off time, I haven't put any attention on making money. That's the problem I have. And we're told the Holy Spirit knows this and will somehow, you know, that God looks after those who look after God, so to speak. So again, the ultimate value of this rehearsal is what people believe is that they're going to shift into a higher realm. Okay, this is all delusion. Now, it is true that we will certainly drop this rehearsal, but that's not shifting into another realm. That's just simply recognizing where we've always been. Okay, that's different. Now, recognizing where we've always been, that path, because we're so used to the idea of rehearsing to shift into a higher realm, we may in the dream seem to shift into a higher realm. We may interpret it that way, and we may have some various shifts that happen. That's possible, right? It's possible. But those shifts are only taking us, moving our comfort zone closer to accepting that where we always have been, where we really are. Where are we really? Where are we really? Where are we really? You see, that's the question. Hey, where are we really? Where are we? Where are we really? Now, we're not trying to answer that question. We're just trying to hold that. Where are we really? Just hold it there. See, this is a big difference between the world and the spiritual path. Where are we really? Don't rush to try and answer that. Hold the question there. Hold this inquiry. Just hold the inquiry there. Where am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? This is like an affirmation. You say, where am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? This is another type of affirmation. It might be even more powerful. The positive ones will say, I am one. I am one. You know, I am one. I am not a body, I am free. But you could also say, where am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? I've never tried this before. This just popped into my mind right now. Where am I really? Wow. Just super powerful. Don't try to answer it. It's an affirmation, not a question. Holy cow. The breakthroughs now are that are just amazing that are happening. Last night, the superiority complex of the world is not inferiority complex. Superiority complex right now, the breakthrough into using questions as affirmations. Where am I really? Or who am I really? Who am I? Now, see, I never understood. Who am I is actually an affirmation. Who am I? You know, who am I? Who am I? Who am I? Who am I? This is actually an affirmation. It's not a question. It's not like a question you're trying to answer. See, we've got it all. We've missed it. Ramana Maharshi said, just say, who am I? Not to try and figure out who I am, but as an affirmation. Hold the affirmation there. That'll automatically burn off, you know, the delusion. Just like, where am I? Where am I really? Or who am I really? Who am I really? Who am I really? Who am I really? Where 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 am I really? This is just very, very striking. Who am I really? 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 Don't try to grab hold of any answer whatsoever. Don't do anything. Don't move. Don't leap. Don't grab. Don't grasp. Don't struggle. Who am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? See, now you could not do this if you were going to be rushing off to some doctor's appointment right now or a meeting or something, right? You could not do this. This is too profound for that. This is extremely profound. You don't want to exercise right now, that is for sure. You know, I've noticed an incredible diminishment in the number of butterflies in this area. Because when I see a butterfly, I realize I haven't seen a butterfly fly for years. And what's that? Oh my gosh, look at that beautiful butterfly. It's been so long since I've seen a butterfly. That's amazing. Saw one. I used to see them all the time, all over the place. It's supposed to be a sign of a healthy ecosystem. Yeah, I'm just, this burn is just like I just ate a Trinidad Marula scorpion, which I don't recommend. Not really, you know, but. It's the potency. It's not like a capsaicin burn, but it's a shake-up. It's a tremendous shake-up. Like an inner earthquake. It's still going on. It's not just a 30-second earthquake. It's, you know, it's a 10-minute earthquake. Imagine a 10-minute earthquake, and you just ride it out. That's like what's happening. Where am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? Who am I really? Who am I really? Who am I really? And an affirmation. Wow. Surface, everything's the same. Everything's the same. It's like I play the piano, I can do anything, you know, sing, whatever, drive, eat. Everything's the same at the surface. But deeper down, this is like a huge shifting, huge earthquake, so to speak. I was just like, I'm just stunned. Wow. Using these, you know, where am I as an affirmation. I've never, ever thought of that. Same with who am I? Never thought of actually using this as an affirmation. I thought it was a question. You know, a question I was supposed to answer. Not at all. It's an attention shifter. You know, it's like, wow. Don't try to do anything about it. Just say it. Where am I really? 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 Like a statement, affirmation. We're not asking the mind, we're not asking our thinking at all just to respond at all. This has to be the strongest affirmation I've ever used. I've used some very strong ones for sure, but this one is so unexpected and just tremendous. Where am I really? 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 Now, Nisargadatta Maharaj said he woke up very quickly. His teacher told him to say, you know what, was it? Follow I am. Follow I am. I am. You know, I am. I am. I am. I am. I am. I am. He is able to rapidly, you know, shift his attention off the dualistic dream. These affirmations are very effective. I can feel, wow. Where am I really? Where am I really? No questioning at all. I'm not thinking, hey, I wonder where I am. Or, no, just a pure spiritual statement. Where am I really? This is spirit speaking to itself, saying, come on, come on. Time to wake up. Where am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? Spirit doesn't need an answer. Spirit knows. Where am I really? Now, just like there's, let's say there's a huge seismic event. You know, you just write it out. You're not looking, oh, what's happening there? Oh, there's a crack appearing there in the wall. Oh, look at the sidewalk there. No way. You're just focusing on staying poised and calm and writing it out. Okay, so it's very much like that, actually. Now, it's a funny thing living here in California my whole life, worried, fearful of earthquakes, and the attitude of like, well, how am I going to ride the next earthquake out is always there in the background of California, really. We don't talk about it, but it's there. It's there. We know the next one is coming. And so, you know, amazingly, this is kind of the attitude you need for the spiritual breakthroughs is, okay, I'm going to just ride this out, you know. All hell's broken loose. Where am I really? Where am I really? Just seismic event, inner seismic event. Just write it out. Just write it out. The last thing you want to do is try to fixate on something, okay? What you want to do is you keep your attention 360 degrees in an earthquake. Everything's rolling, everything's shaking. And you keep your awareness diffuse 360 degrees because anything could be coming at you from any angle, right? Do not fixate on, you know, any particular area. Just stay in that diffuse 360 degree awareness. If you need to move, something's coming, okay, move out of there. Don't fixate. Say, well, what's that coming towards me? You know, oh, I missed it. Oh, how nice I missed it. You know, something fell, a brick fell, okay. No, because there's other stuff could be coming. From you from other angles. So you see something coming from you out of the corner of your eye, you just get out of the way and keep your attention 360 degrees. Don't look and say, what was that I missed? No, you missed it. It missed you. You don't look and see what is it that missed me. You keep your attention. Okay, that one missed me, that one missed me, that one missed me. Like you're in a dodgeball thing. You're dodging this, dodging that, dodging. You stay like that. You just stay, write it out. Write it out. So, in that way, California is helpful. California has some helpful aspects to it, actually. The weather is one. The earthquake thing is one, is another. This more laid-back atmosphere, so-called, can be one. Mind your own business atmosphere is another. People do, unfortunately, in the suburbs of California, they end up smoking pot, taking drugs, because they're so bored, you know, watching television. What do? Or their parents schedule everything for them, so they're constantly going places. They're different situations. But you could also apply these affirmations. And I can tell you that the spiritual path, these seismic events that you're undergoing, that is way more profound than any drug experience. And it's legal, at least it still is. They'll chip everybody soon enough and they'll monitor your every action and say, hey, I saw you were sitting there doing nothing for 4 hours today. That's impermissible, that's a mark on your record. And if you keep getting enough marks, you're going to have to be sent to a re-education camp where we train you how to stay very busy and occupied. One moment, please. All right, a little interruption there. Which knocks you off track for sure. But that happens, that happens. All right. It's hard to get back into the subtle flow of it. So we were at, where am I really? Where am I really? Where am I really? Now, who's going to succeed? The ones who are able to set aside time and actually, you know, get that done, setting aside enough time now. The earthquake continues, the rumbling, the churning is like, wow. This is because this is just a seismic event of shifting from the negative questioning into using those negative questions. Where am I really? As a positive affirmation, where am I really? Where am I really? You see, like that. Wow. I'll probably go eat some ice cream after this because you can't fathom it. It's like an earthquake. You don't know how much damage, not damage, but change has happened. For instance, this isn't doing damage to me. It's shifting. It is changing my outlook for sure. How much outlook has changed? I don't know. When the earthquake's going, you don't go around assessing the damage when the earthquake's still going on, right? No way. That comes later, and you have to look out for aftershocks, of course. So you just write it out, and don't be in a hurry to assess damage. Or change. Let's say, okay, tomorrow, maybe I'll assess it tomorrow. I'll sleep on it. So that's what I do. I try to make as much progress as possible in any day. And then instead of assessing it at all, I'll sleep on it. Say, well, I'll sleep on it and see how it feels in the morning. And then when I get up in the morning, I say, you know, I really need to make another big push today. So I never really get around to assessing it, which is great. Don't try to assess the progress you're making. Just keep making it. See, that can't be bad. If you keep making it, it can't be bad, right? For sure. For sure. It's a winning strategy for sure. But the mind's always saying, hey, you know, I need to assess it. I say, okay, well, maybe tomorrow. Maybe tomorrow we'll do some assessment. I don't know. Maybe let's just sleep on it. Oh, okay. We'll sleep on it. So there's no way to assess What's happened here? Where am I really? Who am I really? Who am I really? Who am I really? I tend to resonate more with where am I? Where am I really? That's because when you realize I'm in pure spaciousness, or you know, all is in pure spaciousness. That's you know, you're free of time. You're free of the delusion. So where am I really? Where am I really? Trying to compare seismic shocks in any way. Not trying to do any comparison. We're just writing it out here. We're just writing it out. So I like this path. I really like it. It's very different than what I thought, you know, most people are trying to teach or something. Very different. It's to bring these seismic shocks upon myself through these shifting of concepts, shifting of emphasis in various ways like this. Wow, where am I really? Where am I really? And then just write out the seismic, the psychic seismic shock. And you just spend time with patiently letting the aftershocks happen. So I enjoy it. I'm not trying to do anything else. I would say for this day and age is a terrific path, because it seems like a drug trip almost, right? So many people, young people, have been into drugs, right? So many, the amount of people who've tried drugs, young people coming through the last, three or four generations is getting more and more, right? And this is like a drug trip, except it's not. There's intensity to it. There's a wow factor to it. So it's a good alternative to drugs. It's a tremendous alternative to drugs. You know, we know that just saying people just say no to young people, they're not going to listen. What we should be saying is, hey, here's a better alternative. Here's an alternative you should try. You should try this. There's a better alternative. Now, the Jesus people did that back in the 60s and 70s. Say, hey, try Jesus. I didn't quite understand what they're talking about, but they did have something for sure. They did have something because they were experiencing intensity. They said, this is better. It's better than drugs. But I can tell you, this is better than drugs. I mean, aren't drug people thrill seekers? A lot of them thrill seekers. Well, what could be more thrilling than riding out some tremendous inner earthquake? It's like this. I mean, all these, thrillmeisters think they're so tough, or think they're so, what, thrill-seeky. They're such thrillmeisters. And then if they really are, then, hey, come on here and let's have this inner seismic earthquake, This is beyond anything that you can get from the body, from drugs and sex and music and food and graphics and all that stuff. No, this is beyond that. This is beyond it. This has a real profound reverberation. Since we delusionally believe in depth, this is like the undoing of depth. So it seems to reach all the way down through all depth that we're imagining, and say, hey, wait a minute, maybe there is no depth here. That is beyond anything that you're going to get. And you're completely in control of it. It's free. It's smooth. Everything, is way better. Way, way better. And it leads to realization, which is the ultimate. So it's a winner on all fronts. Your reactions are not impaired. You can function perfectly well. Superficially, you can drive. Everything's fine. You probably don't want to do any of those things simply because it takes your attention off of this profundity. But you certainly can. It's legal. It's free, it's legal. Imagine if you could just trigger your own inner earthquake like this, that's leading to ultimate pure happiness, then wouldn't you be doing that? So you can use anything as an affirmation if you understand it. You could say Jesus. The Jesus people would say Jesus, 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 Jesus. They're not asking for anything. Don't ask, hey, Jesus, help me. Or what is Jesus? No, you're just saying Jesus. Hello? Yeah, it's an affirmation. You're not trying to get it because it's self-evident. You got to understand that where am I really? Where I am is completely self-evident. So all we're doing is we're dropping the facade of superiority to self-evidency. Dropping the facade of superiority to self-evidency. That's all we're doing. Where am I really? 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 Now, this is certainly powerful enough. You don't have to go looking for something else. The drug people, their high is never quite what they want, and so they're always shopping for another high, for something else. You know, it's like, maybe I can get something else. Maybe. So spiritual people are often that way too. They're looking for something profound. They say, maybe I want something more profound. Can I find something more profound? What about this teacher here? What about that? What about that? What about that? This is super profound. It is profound enough for anyone. Where am I really? Where am I really? So instead of smoking a joint, why don't you just say, where am I really? Then wait a little while, another puff. Where am I really? Then wait, where am I really? 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 Not a question. Where am I really? 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 Funny thing is, is that most parents will probably want their kids to smoke pot rather than say this affirmation, where am I really? They say, oh, there's something wrong with their mind. Hey, why don't you just smoke, if you want to get high, why don't you just smoke pot? That's literally a fact. I mean, there's so many parents today having grown up that way say, you know what, it's not so bad for my kids, you know, it doesn't bother me so much. Smoke pot, that's okay. But don't be saying, where am I really? I mean, that's frightening. Yeah, it's really frightening. So it's the new counterculture. It's the new cool thing. It's what our parents really, you know, it's what your parents don't really want you to do, is to say, hey, where am I really? That's what they don't want you to do. So get hip to that, you know, get hip to that. It's funny, but it's true. See, all the drugs do is they get you to say, well, to feel like, well, I'm not sure where I am. I'm not really sure where I am. That's not it. Stay with the state of affirmation. Where am I really? Where am I really? We're not trying to just be unsure. We're not trying to reach some unsureness. Where am I really? Where am I really? Thank you.